In this video demonstration today, I'm going to show how to perform a control loop response measurement on a switch mode power supply using an InfiniVision X-Series oscilloscope. Now, a control loop response measurement is basically a Bode gain and phase measurement. You typically use either a network analyzer or a frequency response analyzer to perform this type of measurement. It's a very critical measurement to characterize the stability of your power supplies. But it can also be performed with an InfiniVision X-Series oscilloscope if it has the power app option. Now today, what I'm going to be testing is a switch mode power supply off of a demo board from PicoTest. I'm probing right here across the shunt resistor. Now I'm also going to be using, and it's required, an isolation transformer, because what we're going to do is inject a low-level signal across that shunt resistor that's in the feedback path. And we can't directly connect the output of the scope's waveform generator to that shunt resistor. It needs to be isolated. The scope's generator is grounded. So we can do it with an isolation transformer. What I'm using is also from PicoTest. It's called the J2101 injection transformer. So what I have set up here is, first of all, you can see the BNC connected to the WaveGen output, and this is the output of the generator connected across the shunt resistor, which is built into this board. It's only 5 ohms. The feedback path voltage resistive divider network, I believe, is in the hundreds of k-ohm range. So 5 ohms doesn't affect it at all. It's built in. You might consider doing the same on your power supplies and just leave it there. It's really great for test purposes. So I have 2 probes connected across the shunt resistor to measure what's V in and V out. What I'm using is 1-to-1 passive probes, not the standard 10-to-1 passive probes that come with the scope. 10-to-1 passive probes are going to divide the signal down by a factor of 10. We're really looking at low-level signals. 1-to-1 probes work a whole lot better. So let's go ahead and get started with the demo. I'm going to begin with a default setup so we can set everything up from scratch. Next, I'll go into the Analyze menu and select the Power application. Under the Analysis key are all the various power measurements that you can perform with the power options, such as power quality, current, harmonics, RDS on, switching loss, and so on. Now, we have videos on all of these, so I encourage you to go watch those if you're interested. Now, down here at the bottom are 2 frequency response measurements, power supply rejection ratio, and control loop response, or Bode plot. I'm going to select control loop response. Next, I'll go into the setup menu. First thing I'll do, just to show you, the question mark over here is the help screen. And this brings up a diagram, a connections diagram, that shows you how to connect everything. And so you can see we have our WaveGen connected to the input of the 1-to-1 transformer, and there's our 5 ohm shunt resistor. This is the feedback path of the power supply. So we're probing V out up here with channel 2, and V in, which is the top of the feedback path below the shunt resistor, with channel 1, that's V in. Now let's go back and set everything up, see what our options are. There are 2 basic modes: sweep mode, which is the normal mode that you would use for performing this type of measurement. I'll show single later. There's a start frequency and a stop frequency. The start frequency can be as low as 20 hertz. Stop frequency max is 20 megahertz. I'm going to only test up to 10 megahertz for this particular device. You can select points per decade, up to 50 points per decade. You can define which of the scope's inputs are VN, in this case channel 1, and V out is channel 2. We'll use the defaults. And then the most critical setup is your test amplitude. The default is 200 millivolts. Most frequency response analyzers specify it in either dBm or RMS. I'm going to set this to 100 millivolts. We're going to start with a low-level signal. We're going to do the test a couple of times. So this is equivalent to about 35 millivolts into 50 ohms. So everything is set up. We just press apply. Now, one advantage of the oscilloscope solution is you can see the waveforms during the test. Now, one thing you can see it looks like a very noisy waveform. What we're seeing is all the switching or output ripple of this power supply. And what you can be monitoring during the test is looking for distortion. That's something you can't do with a network analyzer or frequency response analyzer. So there's our first test. Now, I'd like to point out a couple of things. First of all, it immediately shows you PM, which stands for phase margin, 54.82 degrees at approximately 60 kilohertz. That's this point that it's marking right here. And it also measures gain margin at approximately 141 kilohertz. Now we can move the cursors independently. There's two independent cursors. The phase margin and gain margin measurements stay there. Now you'll notice up here at the lower frequencies, we have what I call chatter going on. The problem there is we have our signal to noise ratio is too low. And we have similar phenomena going on here at the upper frequencies. Things are pretty good here in the mid-range around the 0 dB crossover point. So how do we fix these to get a higher resolution measurement? One method is to simply pump up the test amplitude. So let's do that now. I'm going to go to the other extreme and put in a really big signal, 2 volts peak to peak. So let's run the test again. Now with the higher test amplitude, our signal to noise ratio has improved a lot, but notice the distortion on the yellow waveform. That's VN coming off of channel one. That distortion is eventually going to transfer over to Vout as well, the green waveform. So there's our final measurement. So you can see the chatter is gone. But one thing I want you to notice, now take a look at the phase margin measurement, 67.8 degrees at about 46 kilohertz. If you remember, the first measurement we performed, it measured about 60 kilohertz. So things have changed. And the problem is we fixed our signal to noise problem, but now we have distortion and inaccurate measurements. Now let me show you how to optimize, find what is the correct amplitude to test at. We can go back and test at a single frequency. I could go to the setup menu and remember where I showed single. Another alternative is go to the table view. This shows all of the measurements showing the frequency, amplitude, gain, and phase. Let's first test at the low end, 100 hertz, and now it's going to set up a single measurement at that frequency, show us the gain and phase at that frequency, and there we can look at the waveform that it's testing. Let me turn the intensity up. And here you can see the green is V out. That looks good, looks sinusoidal. The yellow is VN. Now there's a lot of noise on that signal. It's not noise, it's output ripple. But also look at these spikes here. This is distortion. Let's go into the WaveGens menu, select amplitude, and let's begin reducing the amplitude until we see those noise spikes go away. Okay, so that's down around 800 millivolts. Now, if you look closely, you can see what looks like an envelope riding on top of that switching noise. That's what we're measuring. We're measuring the fundamental within all that switching noise. Now, let's go to a different frequency. And this time we'll use this menu here and just go directly to, let's go to 60 kilohertz, which is the approximate 0 dB crossover point. That is actually the most critical point. Take a look at the waveforms. So there you can see VN, things are flattening on the sine wave, and V out, the green waveform, is beginning to look triangular. So this is distorted, and that was what was inducing the error on that phase margin measurement where it measured 47 kilohertz instead of 60 kilohertz. Again, we could go back into the WaveGen menu, start reducing the amplitude, and find the optimum amplitude at this frequency. Let's just go back and let's test at the high end. Let's go up to 1 megahertz. So there it is at 1 megahertz. This is with a 2-volt peak-to-peak input. If you look at the envelope here, it looks like a sine wave. It's not distorting, so we can see at the high end, it can easily stand a very high voltage. If I press stop, you can see the switching noise. Switcher is running at about 3 megahertz. But what the measurement does is it pulls out the test signal fundamental, which in this case is at 1 megahertz. So you go through this process, test at a couple of points, find out what the optimum amplitude is, and probably what you're going to find is there's not a single amplitude that's perfect. So for that, let's go back to the sweep mode. We have amplitude profile. This is where you can set amplitudes for different frequency ranges. So I've already gone through the process. I'm going to start at about 800 millivolts at 100 hertz. I'm going to keep it constant through that decade up to 1 kilohertz. Then at 10 kilohertz, I'm going to ramp down to about a half a volt. And then at 100 kilohertz, I'm going to ramp all the way down to 100 millivolts. Now I'm going to ramp back up. Let's go 1 volt at 1 megahertz and 2 volts at 10 megahertz. So it's going to stay constant from 100 hertz to 1K. Then it's going to move down from 800 millivolts to 500 millivolts at 10K, ramp down further to 100K, ramp up and ramp up. So let's go. So there you can see we don't have the signal to noise ratio problem. The waveforms are not distorted. They look sinusoidal if you can filter out the switching noise in your eyes. And we'll probably get a very accurate measurement of the phase margin. It should be back to about 60 kilohertz. So again, it measures 59.48 kilohertz. So there's a good measurement using the amplitude profile capability. As you've seen in this video, you can now perform frequency response measurements using a Keysight oscilloscope. Now, these are the only scopes on the market that can perform these. There are some real key advantages of the measurement capabilities of this scope compared to other solutions. First of all, you can see the time domain waveform, see if there's distortion. You have one instrument can perform a broad range of power-related measurements that you may need to characterize. And it's also a fairly inexpensive solution compared to a network analyzer. If you'd like to watch the other videos on power testing or download an application note on this particular application I showed today, go to the URL listed on your screen. And thanks for watching.